All right, welcome to the last talk of the day. So, again, we have some stuff to give out. So, I hit people with swords. I don't throw things very well. So if you want stuff, the best option is for you to come closer. But you can have a book for coming up close. Well, all you care about is the moose, right? Wow. So you all run up just for the moose. All right. So this is not attack the person. Like, this is not football or rugby or whatever. You're not supposed to attack the people. So again, the Shmoocon, the only conference with balls. These are not intended as a stress reliever. These are intended to, if you are listening to a talk, for some reason Matt goes way off topic, and you think what Matt is talking about is bullshit, stand up and throw a ball at him. Let him know in a very visceral sense that you think he's wrong, and make it a conversation. If you're not willing to stand up and come up to the microphone and ask him a question, that's why we give you a ball, is not to make you so you can squeeze it, it's so you can throw it at a speaker. And make this an interactive event.
I will note, the speakers are apparently provided with potatoes to throw back. So I'm not sure where these came from, but that's how I'm going to use them. So,
yeah, that was from the fire talks last night. But, you know, be aware if you're in the audience, the potatoes. All right, so again, 9 o'clock tonight. We are having our party in this room, so everybody will have to get out. We'll clear the room, clear all the chairs so we can actually all congregate. Music, dancing, a lot of good conversations, and alcohol if you are the appropriate age. So again, 9 o'clock here, you must have your Shmoocon badge to enter. So if you're gonna get dressed up, make sure you put your badge back on. Again, we have all of our t-shirts that are available for reward for donating to charity, one of three very worthy charities in registration. That'll be open for another hour or so. And past t-shirts and past bags are available for a $10 donation for the same charities. So I have two more balls. Wow, that was pretty bad. So no ball for you. All right, so with that, I'd like to stop talking and let you see somebody you're actually wanting to hear from. So without any further ado, I'd like to please introduce Matt Blaze. So please give a warm Shmoocon welcome.
Okay, thanks for that. Okay, so this is a bit of a strange talk for Shmoocon and also for me, because it's actually based on a law review paper that was written by three computer scientists and one lawyer. So this is a joint work with Stephanie Pell, who is actually within range that I can see, so you can raise your hand. So throw things at her. And Steve Pellevin and Susan Landau. So three of us, me, Steve Pellevin, and Susan Landau, are computer scientists and computer science scholars. And then Stephanie is a legal scholar. And what we were looking at was the question of the distinction between content and metadata in law. And normally you think of content versus metadata as a technical question. But in fact, it's a pretty important legal question, particularly when it comes to wiretap law. And actually the original name for this paper, we started out with the metadata is the message, and I'm trying to be a reference to Marshall McLuhan, who all you kids have never heard of. And then we realized that sometimes actually the message is metadata. And we kind of ended up throwing our hands and deciding that the title was, it's too complicated, because that actually described what this distinction looks like. So what are we actually talking about here? So under US law, content of communications gets very strong legal protection. It gets among the strongest kind of legal protection against government intrusion that the law can provide. It's actually even higher than the standard required to do things like break into your home and search it or arrest you. But communications metadata, things like the phone numbers you dial on a phone, get only very weak protection. In fact, much weaker than people think. And so one question is, we pretty much know how this works with telephones. In fact, all the laws were written and decided when electronic communication and wiretapping meant phone tapping. But we're actually a lot less certain what this means when it comes to the internet. For those of you who are not technologists in the audience, the internet is not quite like the phone system. And that's as technically deep as I'm likely to get. But in fact, that observation is in fact a fairly deep one. So in particular, the internet does more things than the old phone system did. It doesn't allow you to simply make or answer a call, which are the two basic services of plain old telephone service, or POTS service as it existed. So it does different things for the user. In fact, it doesn't do the things that the phone system does for the user. And then when you look at it, at how it's implemented, of course, it's based on a very fundamentally different architecture. It's not a connection-oriented architecture. It's a packet-oriented infrastructure and architecture, no circuit switching, at least as exposed to the user. And it inverts the basic assumption of the phone system, which was that you would have really, really smart networks and really dumb endpoints, and requires rather really smart endpoints and really can get by with pretty dumb infrastructure. Now, from a technical point of view, those are actually fairly deep distinctions. They're sort of succinctly said, but they have a really profound impact on both the way we implement it from a technical point of view, but also on the way we apply the law to it. Historically, also, the internet is not heavily regulated, and either, we can argue about how much this follows from the lack of regulation. We tend to have new applications in it all the time, and one of the nice properties of the internet from a technical point of view, and not so nice properties of it from the regulatory and legal point of view, is that you don't really have to tell anyone when you're doing a new application. They can just kind of pop up. So one question is, can we apply the rules that were invented in a phone era to the internet when it comes to things like what are the rules for government surveillance? Okay, so that's the sort of high-level basics of the internet technology. Now, here is an equally high-level, that is to say, embarrassingly undetailed description of the U.S. Of U.S. law. So that is, this is everything you learn in law school, I've been told, in about 30 seconds. The U.S. has a formal written constitution. It was written by well-educated men who were familiar with problems from British law, which had about 500 years of history behind it. Laws and government practices must be consistent with the Constitution, and the courts, in particular the Supreme Court, are the arbiter to that. There, you now have the equivalent of 3 years of law school. In that. Now, going down a little bit deeper, the part of the Constitution that we're really concerned with when it comes to wiretaps is not actually even in the main part of the Constitution, but rather in amendments to the Constitution that are called the Bill of Rights. And in particular, we are largely concerned with which amendment for this? Number 4,
right? It's not all Second Amendment. So we're concerned with the Fourth Amendment, the text of which says, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrant shall issue but upon probable cause supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the person or things to be seized. And that's what it says. And you'll note that this text dates from 1789, which, and now we will go with a high-level view of history, was before the invention of the internet. It was also before the invention of the telephone. Now, you'll also notice something about this. It's very broad language, and it contains a number of not-so-bright lines. And one of the words that doesn't have that many bright lines, and it's highlighted in red here, unreasonable searches and seizures. So this doesn't say that reasonable searches and seizures can't happen. It doesn't say that no searches and seizures can ever happen, but only unreasonable searches and seizures are prohibited. And it also says that warrants, whatever they're required for, have to be supported by oath or affirmation and establish probable cause that this is a search that will turn something up. So, 1789, written before the internet and before the telephone and even before the commercialization of electricity. This is where all of the rules, the basic rules for wiretaps, which very much depend on technology, come from. So one question is, are wiretaps searches for the purposes of the Fourth Amendment? Does a wiretap require a warrant issued on probable cause before the government can do it to listen in on the content of your phone calls? So it turns out the Supreme Court didn't actually address this question until, first of all, after the invention of the telephone. And it took them until 1928 before this question first came up. And, what did the Supreme Court do? Well, there was a case called Olmstead versus the United States, 1928, and they looked at the text of the Fourth Amendment, and they noticed that it said nothing about communication. It said persons, houses, papers, effects. And they noticed that there's nothing in the Fourth Amendment that seems to directly address what a telephone does. And they ruled that that a telephone wiretap is not a Fourth Amendment search. And that's actually very surprising to people, right? Because we all kind of think that, wait a minute, a wiretap is clearly a Fourth Amendment search. So that was 1928. In 40 years later, 39 years later, the Supreme Court did something very unusual, which is that it revisited the same question, or effectively the same question, in a second case called Katz versus United States, in which a phone booth was monitored by the government. And Katz basically addressed the same question, and the court ruled in precisely the opposite way in 1967. So they basically observed that the purpose of the Fourth Amendment is not to protect objects, but rather to protect people. And so the effect was that from then on, the law required a search warrant based on probable cause, according to the Constitution, before phone content could be intercepted by the government. Now, that is where we get the principle of wiretap law from today, from this 1967 Supreme Court ruling. And I'll talk a little bit later about what happened after that and the laws that implemented. Congress actually went farther than the Supreme Court, but they still haven't really addressed the internet. Now, there's a second part of this. How many people have heard of a pen register? Right. How many people have heard of a trap and trace? So there's another type of wiretap, and it's actually the probably the most common type of wiretap, much more common than listening in on a phone call, called a pen register, in which the government puts a device, and I put device in scare quotes because it's no longer actually a device, it's simply programming of the phone switch software, but it's legally defined as a device that records the numbers that you dial on your phone. And there's a similar concept of a trap and trace, which is a device, that is software, or a, you know, just looking at the records, that records who is calling you. So one is recording who you're calling, the other is recording who is calling you. And in general, we think of those things with almost the same kind of rules, and they almost never get one without the other. There are a lot more of these than there are actual content wiretaps. So one question that CATS didn't address is the question of whether pen registers and trap and trace devices are searches. And that led to the most confusing set of circumstances for applying wiretap law to the internet that led us to the sort of the problem that we are facing today. So it was a case of called Smith versus Maryland in 1979. That's 12 years after after CATS. The Supreme Court addressed this question of whether or not pen registers are searches under the Fourth Amendment. And they established sort of two important pieces of law. First, they said no. And they said no for a couple of reasons. You've first given the numbers that you dial to a third party, that is the phone company. That's called the third party doctrine. And essentially it says that something that you voluntarily give to a third party, that is not the person you're talking to, is not content under the Fourth Amendment, is not a search under the Fourth Amendment. You've already ceded your reasonable expectation of privacy in it. But you have to have voluntarily shared this with a third party. That is, you have to know you're doing it. You do know you're doing it when you dial a phone number or give the number to an operator. It has to be done to a third party. So in particular, the quote from this case is really important. And this is the one that we're going to have to parse really, really carefully as both technologists and legal and policy people. All telephone users in 1979 realized that they must convey phone numbers to the telephone company, since it's through telephone company switching equipment that their calls are completed. So you know that you're doing this and it's voluntary. Okay, so Congress in 1968 after CATS and in 1986 a little bit after Smith passed a couple of laws, the Wiretap Act and the Pen Register Statute. Which basically established the rules under the Supreme Court decisions. And one of the things that they did was actually created more rigid standards than the court required for content wiretaps. They required not just probable cause, but showing that it was really necessary compared with other investigative methods. They call that a super warrant. And in order to get a warrant, you basically not only have to have probable cause, but you have to convince a judge that you have probable cause. You go to a judge and, you don't, unless you're a police officer, but the police officer or prosecutor goes to a judge and makes the case to the judge, and the judge makes a judgment based on what you say. For pen registers and trap and trace devices, which according to Smith are not searches, basically what the government required was that the police certify that they've that the information they want is likely to be relevant to an ongoing investigation. And that is simply a self-certification. There's no warrant required. This is more like a subpoena, in that no judge is passing judgment before the fact on whether or not it's relevant. The police simply certify that. Okay, so that is these are the rules as applied to not just the telephone, but to electronic communication. And we have to basically take these telephone era rules and figure out how they apply in a world where telephones are becoming less and less important from one day to another. Okay, so what technology are we looking at? So I'm going to go pop up to computer science and technology for a moment, which is, since I'm not a lawyer, this is where I'm comfortable. And if you ask me, how do I think about a communications system? What I would do as a computer scientist is I would say, well, I want to think abstractly. And what I want is a model of a communication system, and I want the law to map to some model of a communication system. What's a good model of a communication system? Well, I just happen to have one right here. This is from 1948. Does anyone recognize this? This is figure one of maybe the most important technical paper of the 20th century. All right, Claude Shannon, wrote this really important paper called A Mathematical Theory of Communication, in which he came up with a model for a communication system, a general model for a communication system, which is to say any communication system can be mapped back to this model. And you know what we could do is I've annotated this slightly by describing the two participants, as we normally call them, Alice and Bob, who wants to communicate. Alice wants to communicate with Bob, so she's an information source. She sends a message to a transmitter, which creates a signal, sends that through a medium, which is mixed with a noise source, creating a received signal that's sent to a receiver, creating a message which is sent to the recipient, Bob. And any communication system, this picture, really, really important because it can describe pretty much any communication system that can be rigorously modeled. Now, it would be nice if that were how we came up with these rules, because we could say, okay, well, we just have to figure out how a communication system maps to this. So here's a particular communication system. This is the telephone system as it existed in the 1970s. So you have Alice and Bob, who have telephone handsets. And you know, Alice will communicate with a telephone central office, maybe sending touch tones, DTMF tones, to a phone switch, which routes the call to another phone switch, which routes the call ultimately to Bob. And then the phone system gets out of the picture, and now Alice and Bob have a connection. So, whoops. Alice and Bob have a connection with each other. Okay, so one observation is that both Katz and Smith looked at a particular communication system, the phone system, rather than as a general model of communication system generally. That is, they were dependent on a particular communications technology as they understood it. And if you actually look at the decision, the first thing that becomes apparent is that they were not looking at Shannon. If they were, we'd be having a much shorter conversation about how this applies today, because it would be a much more simple and rigorous process. They were also not looking at the internet, because you know, in 1967 it didn't exist, and in 1979 they didn't know about it. It also, interestingly, wasn't really the 1970s phone system either, but more like the 1920s phone system. So what did the 1920s phone system look like? Well, it wasn't Alice and Bob, because those modern names didn't exist. We'll call them Aloysius and Bartholomew. And okay, maybe these are a little bit anachronistic. Wait till you see the next picture. Aloysius calls the phone central office, which is populated by operators who appear to be living in the 1930s, although Aloysius is living in the 1890s, but never mind. It says, I would like to call my friend Bartholomew to the operator. The operator then calls another operator and creates a connection between Aloysius and Bartholomew that way. Now, one of the things about this model is you can't not know that you're talking to a third party when you convey the metadata, who you want to call there, because you are actually talking to another human being in this operator-assisted model of communication that existed in kind of the 1920s and that judges were largely thinking about. And in fact, if you look at the Smith case, they basically say, well, all this modern fancy switching equipment, well, you know, everybody remembers back when you had to make a call through the operator, so it's, you know, it's really the same thing. So it's very much rooted in this sort of 1920s particular communication system, and then eventually the operator gets out of the way, and Aloysius and Bartholomew have their content. Okay, so that is basically, instead of looking at this general model of a communication system into which we can put the internet, this is rooted in really about a 100-year-old version of the phone system. Now, I'm going to make one observation, and this is an extremely unsatisfying observation to technologists, but I'm going to make it anyway. If you throw anything, don't throw it at me, throw it in the sort of I think that direction is the way the Supreme Court building is. If the Supreme Court rules on something, it doesn't matter if it's technically wrong. That's not an answer once the Supreme Court has ruled on it. Because it's still the law even if it makes no sense technically. And I'm sorry, but it's not my fault. It's just actually how things are. So what do we do? Well, do we just let the Supreme Court say completely crazy things? No, instead, what my legal scholar friends and my successful lawyer friends tell me is what you have to do is find a way of distinguishing current facts from past rulings. So one question, the question is not, did the court create sensible rules based on the facts that they had? Because that ship sailed. The question is whether the current facts of communication systems still apply or whether or not we might need new rules. Okay, so let's look at the legality of collecting data on phone lines and on the internet. So for collection to be legal, it has to be authorized by statute. It has to not break the law, and it has to be compatible with the Constitution, compatible with the Fourth Amendment. If you want to collect content, you need a warrant based on probable cause, with a few exceptions here and there. Collection of metadata requires that the data be voluntarily given to a third party and that it's permitted by statute. And then there are exceptions to all of this when things are reasonable. Okay, so one question is, what's the difference between content and metadata? What's the difference between content and metadata on the 1920s phone system? Well, we know the answer to that question. Who you're calling is metadata, and what you say in the call is content. What's the difference between content and metadata on the internet? Yeah. Okay, why not? So how do we actually apply that, right? So one question is, are IP addresses metadata or are they content? Well, we probably have strong opinions that these are mostly in the mostly in the metadata. What about email addresses? Well, what are you voluntarily giving and who are you giving it to? And so this is what we set out to do when we wrote our paper and we did our research on this. We tried to take a technical look at the internet and how the internet works, and analyze the protocols not from a technical perspective, but rather from a legal perspective. So we kind of switched gears, right? Normally you look at something technically and you analyze it technically. We tried to look at something technically and then analyze it legally to see what from what the Supreme Court has told us, we can get good answers to and what we can't. All right, now here's another sort of technical observation, that the internet is based on a layered architecture. That is, what's content and what's metadata changes depending on what layer of abstraction on the internet you look at. So we have things like these layers, and you know, who knows how many there are. There's somewhere between 9 and 3 or 4. I'm going to just say application transport network and link and physical layer. They're implemented on hosts, but then you communicate with a router, and now from the router's point of view, the application and the transport layer aren't really of concern to the router. They become content down at the network layer. Which is all that the routers of the internet are concerned with. And then only when it finally reaches its destination do you kind of draw this distinction between the application and transport layer stuff and so on. So maybe we can just look at a packet and draw a line somewhere. That would be kind of nice and satisfying if we could look at a packet and draw a line and say, everything above this layer is content, and everything below here, these headers, are metadata, or above or below, depending on which order you draw the packets in. But you know, maybe that would be a nice thing. But no, wait a minute, that's not all there is to it. There's this idea of voluntarily giving to a third party. Okay, so the transport and the application layer are kind of end-to-end from a protocol designer's point of view, in that the information in them isn't really given to a third party, but what parties are we talking about and when? The network itself has an awful lot of third parties in it, and some of them are involved in your communication before you actually even get to communicate with them. So you're communicating with things like the DNS system. You may be dealing with a search engine before you ever actually communicate with what you think of as the other party to your communication. Also, the network may be entirely owned and operated by you. So if you've got a wireless network in your home, you're not voluntarily giving anything to a third party if you're communicating between your host and your printer. There's no third party involved because you own the entire network. So this, like, just divide up a packet and decide that this part of the packet is always going to be content and this part of the packet is always going to be metadata, and it's just that simple, doesn't actually lead to results that are compatible with what the law is actually telling us. What the law is telling us is actually much, much more complicated when you apply those rules. So we have this problem of legal definitions that don't really nicely match up with architecture. So some of what's in the transport layer, that is the stuff that we'd look at and say is clearly the end-to-end, no third party involved, wouldn't meet the definition of content. It's not substance, purport, or meaning of a conversation, which is the legal definition of content. So things like TCP port numbers don't really have meaning or substance to them in any content sense, even though they are above the network layer. Some of the things at the network layer, on the other hand, aren't the definition of metadata, which involves dialing, routing, addressing, and signaling information. Not everything in the network layer itself is that. Things like the IPID field, which actually reveals something about the host that's communicating. So we solved this problem not the way a technologist would solve it, which is to say, screw you lawyers, your definitions are terrible, but rather we added some definitions of our own, and in particular we came up with a concept called architectural content. And that's content that is transported unexamined by some layer in the protocol stack. And architectural metadata is sort of the complementary metadata definition of that. Here's a sort of a picture giving you the idea that these concepts cross our sort of normal packet model. We can't just draw this line inside a packet. Okay, so bear with me for a moment, because this will start to get interesting and and relevant, and we'll see that we're going to be running into some problems that are going to be very hard to figure out how to solve, probably fairly soon. So what about addresses? Well, there are more kinds of addresses. There are link layer addresses. So link layer addresses are usually DRAS, right? So they are usually they're usually metadata, but they're not always given to a third party. In fact, usually they're not given to a third party. So are these things that can be gotten without a warrant? Well, the third party doctrine part of this doesn't seem to apply. On the other hand, if you happen to move from your home network into something like a hotel's open Wi-Fi network, then maybe you are voluntarily giving them to a third party. On the other hand, what happens when you have your home network and you didn't turn any encryption on? Should you have known that you were voluntarily giving this to any third party in your neighborhood? Well, the answer is probably different for the people in this room than for the parents of the people in this room. So IP addresses, well, you know, these look an awful lot like metadata, both architecturally and legally. They're clearly given to third parties when things reach the internet itself, and they're clearly addressing information. But on the other hand, how much does the average person know about IP addresses? Do you know what your IP address is? Do you know you have one? Do you know that it actually maps back and becomes kind of personally identifiable information about the internet subscriber? Well, let's look at how Smith figured out that phone numbers are metadata. In Smith, the court noted that consumers know that they have phone numbers. They know what their phone numbers are, and they would know that those phone numbers are recorded because they get a phone bill every month that lists all the phone numbers they called and then a shockingly expensive price for calling it. And so you scrutinize your phone bill. Your internet bill does not come with a list of all the IP addresses that you've connected to in all likelihood. So can we say that these have been voluntarily, in the sense of the law, given to a third party? Things like port numbers, again, it becomes fairly clear right until you start to think about the different ways they're used. Questions like carrier-grade NAT, which makes use of port numbers to map things. ISPs sometimes provide firewalling services that block different port numbers. But most users probably don't know anything about this. They don't know that there are port numbers. What do you mean ports? And so on. And so when we apply the sort of legal test of voluntary and knowing, it starts to become a little bit difficult when you apply this to IP for average civilians. And when we talk about IPv6, even technical people don't understand how that works. So the voluntary and knowing test starts to put a lot of stuff outside of the metadata category that we might think is clearly in it. Signaling, the S in DRAS, the metadata stuff, exchanges of messages that set up a connection. Well, the internet doesn't really have connections in the same sense, first of all. On the phone network, it's done by phone company switches that are setting up a connection. Internet signaling is mostly done over TCP, the end-to-end part of the protocol. But on the other hand, ISPs do things like deep packet inspection to do various kinds of things. Is that voluntary and is that knowing? So let's go with a couple of examples. So email, a thing that never gets anyone into any trouble. So how does email work? Well, a very simplified version of email is it goes from a sender's device to an outbound mail server. There it's sent to a recipient's mail server, and the recipient downloads it from that machine. And the mail servers are generally operated by either an ISP or the enterprise. Anyway, this is how email worked in, you know, the 1980s. But of course, now we have things like web-based mail, and people set up their own private email servers, and so on. Now, what is an email address and is the stuff more generally in an email header, is that content or is that metadata? Well, one problem is that the header as a user sees it and the header as the email system architecture sets it up are two very different things. The email address containing your name is actually part of the content of a message. When we look at how an email system works, it's never actually parsed. That name, physical person's name, part of the email address is never actually looked at by the mail protocol, but it's part of the content of the message that gets displayed to the user. So in fact, we have a shadow set of headers that are mostly not really exposed to users who have not set up their own mail servers and aren't SMTP experts. And in fact, this distinction is something that both the courts and the DOJ have gotten wrong in both legal cases and in things like manuals used by prosecutors. And basically, they've said, oh yeah, the header information, including the to and the from line, are definitely metadata, but in fact, that's not really how the technology works. The Supreme Court has never actually ruled on this point. This is an open set of an open legal issue. How about URLs? Are URLs content or are they metadata? And the answer is yes. So they seem simple. You might be able to say, well, let's just cut a URL into its two basic parts, the part containing the host name, which in URL speak is called the authority field, and the part containing the rest of it, which is called the path. And we might think, if we look at how a web server works, wikipedia.org/wiki/metadata, the page that describes metadata that doesn't actually talk about any of this stuff yet, we might say, well, wikipedia.org, that's clearly metadata, but the part where it says wiki/metadata is clearly content because that is only communicated to the web server itself. And that's true in the web as it existed in 1992. But it stops being true when you look at how it stops being true when you look at how the web is actually implemented today. And right now, to tell which of these components is actually sent to a third party or not, you actually have to know things that you can't possibly know as the end user about how the web server has been configured. Is it hosted by a commercial hosting service that's hosting multiple sites at the same IP address? Are you going through a proxy server that's doing DNS lookups for you? Is there a third party rewriting the URL, such as Google, after you do a Google search? And all of these things are things that might change in either direction, whether components of a URL are content or metadata. And worse, you can't possibly know these things, no matter how technically astute you are. It's based on information that the end user is partially just not going to be in possession of. Okay, so another question that leads to voluntariness is location data. When you use an app with a GPS, a mapping app like Google Apps or Apple or what have you, when are you sending your location to a third party, and might that be considered content or metadata? Well, you might say, well, you can tell by whether or not your internet connection is on. You might be in airplane mode as it is on the right, or you might be connected to the net as it is on the left, but in fact, you probably don't have any easy way of finding out when or if your location is being sent. Phones can use cache maps when they're offline, but also might use them when they're online, and you don't really know when that's happening. Even when you're not downloading maps, there are other devices, such as Wi-Fi base stations, that are used to give clues to your location, and they may reveal to fourth parties or fifth parties what your location is, even when you're not aware that this is going on. A standalone GPS unit that has maps downloaded into it might be designed in a way that it never transmits a signal to the outside world and never does that. But you can now build a completely indistinguishable box that's sending your movements constantly to a server somewhere else. And so the fact that two applications can provide exactly the same experience to the user, and one reveals your location constantly, another never reveals your location at all, and then there's an entire continuum in the middle of applications that reveal your location some of the time, but you can't really know when, makes the voluntary knowing conveyance standard really hard to apply here. Got it. Final example, and this is an example where technology has completely overtaken what we've done with the law. If you go back to 1878, which is where the law on the size and weight of things came from, ex parte Jackson, basically this said that the outward form and weight of a letter or package is not protected by the Fourth Amendment. No warrant is required, and that's from 1878. So what would that tell us about an IP packet? Well, that might tell us that surely that means that things like the size of an IP packet would fall under ex parte Jackson, because that doesn't tell us anything about what's in the packet. It just tells us how big the packet is, just like the weight of a package that's sent through the mail. But let's look at what technology has done to this. One of the most astonishing papers that I've read, and I'm not that easily astonished, in the last decade, was White et al. Showed some really devastatingly clever techniques that use the packet lengths of a variable rate encoded encrypted speech for VoIP communication to recover phrases of conversation that are being said, which is to say that the size of packets can be used to reconstruct speech that's being sent over that. So in other words, packet metadata suddenly exposes content, and that's because of somebody coming along and discovering clever analytic techniques that weren't anticipated by the architectural designers. What does that do to the legal status of a wiretap system that looks at packet sizes and figures out what you're saying from that? Okay, so basically, in conclusion, we have no idea how to do any of this. This is a big open set of questions. Hopefully, Stephanie will be on the Supreme Court and will be able to make sensible decisions as the swing vote there. But we're not looking. We're not counting on that. More importantly, everybody should just read our paper. So it's called "It's Too Complicated: How the Internet Upends Cat Smith and Electronic Surveillance Law" by Steve Bellevin, Matt Blaise, Susan Landau, Stephanie Pell, and it's soon to appear in the Harvard, yes, that Harvard Journal of Law and Technology. And you can download it because we all believe in open access. And I have about 2 minutes for questions. Thanks. So please use the microphone.
So since Supreme Court justices don't have to be lawyers, by the way. So if we put you on the Supreme Court, which we could, everybody, Matt Blaise for Supreme Court under Trump, it'll happen. How would you resolve this tension?
Sorry, what was the question?
If you were God, how would you resolve this?
I would have everybody read our paper. And
when it comes to third parties, do you consider the fact that we license Windows, we license Linux, it's even if it's OpenGNU, mm-hmm. We license firmware and hardware, which means it doesn't have to leave your house?
Yeah. So one of the problems is that, which is going to make this even more complicated. It's too complicated now, but it's going to get much too complicated because there's a continuum between a service implemented in the cloud and a service implemented entirely locally. And first of all, you can do the same thing with both, and that's bad enough, but maybe you could find out whether you're using a purely cloud versus purely local thing. But there's a continuum between them that can kind of move back and forth without you even knowing. And so these rules just become almost impossible to apply there.
But the licensing of the firmware and the software is everywhere, regardless of cloud or local.
Yep, that's certainly true. And one question is, will you even be allowed to examine the software in order to figure out what it's doing, in order to figure out what the legal standard is? So it's complicated and hard. Yeah.
Did you do any discovery as far as the blind clicking of the exception of the terms of service?
So we
and
didn't.
How that has to
yeah.
Do
so
with
we didn't look at terms of service or any of those issues. We were totally focused on the Fourth Amendment, but there are good issues there too.
So does the fact that we know how this works make us more vulnerable to warrantless searches of our internet traffic?
So it's interesting because I thought about that question. Like, have I, by writing this paper, have I suddenly made myself more vulnerable to warrantless searches because I knew? So mostly the law is concerned with what a reasonable person would know rather than what a particular person would know. But I haven't been arrested yet, so we'll see.
Yeah. Hey, Matt. Nice to meet you in person, sort of, rather than just on Twitter. Two questions. First of all, where are we with precedent right now? I assume that there is some precedent that's applied to internet investigations, and clearly, law enforcement's going to want it to go as openly as possible.
So mostly we have a lot of individual cases with sort of unsatisfying and contradictory answers.
So nothing's made it to the Supreme
Court
yet?
So we have not had a Katz or a Smith case reach the Supreme Court and make any really definitive, helpful, useful, in a broad sense, pronouncements here.
So are there cases that you think are moving in that direction that might be test cases?
So eventually, two things can happen, right? One thing is that the Supreme Court might rule on something and come up with a completely new set of standards and throw out the third-party doctrine, the things like the mosaic theory of where you put enough metadata together and it looks like content and people have advocated that, but that's not settled by any stretch of the imagination and that's just a thing that some people have advocated. Or you might come up with a bright-line rule in the packets, or you might do something else. The Supreme Court could do that. Or Congress could come up with rules that sort of preempt that, because metadata is mostly within the realm of Congress, but that has not yet happened.
So one other thing that you didn't bring up in your talk, and I think we're all interested in, is where does foreign intelligence surveillance come into this, and how can that feed back into these kinds of searches?
Yeah, it comes into play in someone else's paper, unfortunately.
Okay.
Yeah, right, thanks. Right. Okay, thanks.